My name is Jeff Crilly. Welcome to the Safe Conversation Show. This is a show that's going to change the way the world communicates. I am so thrilled for this inaugural show because this is a time when families are together in a way that they've never been before. And to help kick things off, Dr. Harville Hendrix and Dr. Helen LaKelly Hunt are joining us from their home in Dallas. And in a little bit, we'll be hearing from my daughter and grandson. Wave to everybody in Plano, Sarah Crilly Hill and Caleb Hill.
Hi.
Hello.
All right. We're going to get to you guys in just a second. But let's bring on Harville and Helen, because we've talked about this off camera, Harville and Helen, that it's one of those things where never before in the history of the planet have you had so many people at home. And in some cases that causes stress, that in some cases that is just magical and they're discovering something that they didn't know about their family. So as you look at this time in the history of the planet, what are your reflections?
Well, I think the first thing that comes up for me is how stressed people must be at home and confined at home, since usually you have some sort of a cushion at home, like going to work. And then everybody's home, like we have a daughter and a son-in-law in Italy who have six children. So all eight of them are now confined to a small house in Italy. And the stresses of there are very different. They are good communicators, but the stresses are still high. My guess is that that's a sort of a universal problem and something people dread. And especially when there is the idea that of social distancing. By the way, we're trying to change that term to physical distancing and social connecting, because even though we need to be physically distant now by at least 6 feet, we still need human connection, because human connection is actually what improves the immune system, strengthens it so that we have more resistance to the virus if we should come in contact with it.
Jeff, what I think of when you say it's the first time in our history that we've been confined to home like we are now, I would say also it's the first time in the history of the world that the relational sciences are teachable. It was a psychiatrist who told us that once, saying, with the breakthroughs in the neurosciences in the 1990s, we have learned so much about brain science and certain things, we can now actually teach people to have healthy relationships, not just talk about them. Until the 1990s, people would talk about, gee, I wish we, you know, they would want for it. And Safe Conversations is very unique in that way. We teach people how to shift from conflict to connection.
Yeah, there's probably no bigger time ever in history for the need for that, because relationships are now stressed all across the globe.
This is about de-stressing your home.
Yes, that's so important. Well, let's talk about that, because so many people are fearful, and fear, I think, can bring out the worst in people. And if you've lost your job, now there might be money stresses. And so a home could become very volatile if the conversation isn't safe.
Yes. And will, if it's not safe, because what people don't have conversational skills. We may think that's so natural that people know how to have conversations, but actually people talk, but they don't know really how to have a conversation, because a conversation means you're talking with each other, not to each other or at each other. And there are technologies of talking, one of which Helen and I have developed called Safe Conversation, which when you talk to each other in the way that we teach people, actually calms the brain so that you settle down inside and you can actually do the job you were trying to do in a conversation that when you were talking to each other and it didn't work. We call it talking without criticizing, listening without judgment, and connecting beyond your differences. And we can do that, but we don't have the skills to do it. And that's one of the things that we are so happy that we can make available right now and what we want to be doing on the show.
Well, and I've seen it in action. I've been to a number of your workshops, and we've got some video of that that we're going to be showing. It's magical. I've seen people crying at your workshops, laughing at your workshops, really connecting in a meaningful way. As you pointed out, people are talking. They're not listening. Most of the time, they're just waiting for their chance to say something else. And you famously say that talking is the most dangerous thing people do. What do you mean by that?
Well, talking is the most dangerous thing people do because usually when we talk, we don't take into account the listener and where they might be in their mind. So we assume the listener is available for us to talk. And the listener who may or may not be listening thinks that they're waiting to be available so they can talk. And what happens with that is you come up with polarization instead of connection. We have different points of view, then that gets us into a kind of polarization with each other. Things don't go well. So it becomes dangerous to talk. And also most people don't listen. So that polarization happens. Then your neurochemistry is activated, cortisol and adrenaline, and you go then into a kind of self-protection and defense. And now you have a problem. And the problem is talking, not the problem you were talking about.
Well, I want to bring Helen in because what touched me is how transparent you guys are, that you say at one point, although you had all this knowledge, you were near divorce. Helen, how did you get to that point?
Oh, it started when we were dating. I loved that Harville wanted to write a book, and he told me what the book would be about helping people learn to love each other. You can want to love each other, but if you don't know how, you end up mad at people that you want to learn to love. And I was divorced, and Harville was divorced, and so I asked him when we were dating, we were both single parents, you know, what do you want to do with your life? And he told me about this book, and I fell in love with this book. And I ultimately proposed, and I said, would you marry me? But the fact was, on our dating, we fought, and when we were married, we were fought. And then Harville got famous, and I thought, this is so embarrassing because we fight at home. And so then we did publicly announce we were divorcing. And I get, Jeff, you know, that's a really thoughtful question that you're asking, because if you think this was easy for us, it's not necessarily easy, but it is simple to do and learn, and all you have to do is commit to doing it. And if you do that, you'll prevent enormous unnecessary suffering. Yeah. We're so glad, Jeff, you're getting this on, having us on your show.
Yeah, and we finally figured out what to do and then did it and had a remarriage ceremony. And we consider our real wedding was 20 years after our actual one, because that's when we put in place what we had written about, discovered, taught, and we were doing in therapy, but hadn't done ourselves. And so the point about that is you can know something, but if you don't do something, the knowing doesn't help you.
And I'm married to the man of my dreams. We have the happiest marriage. No one in our family is fighting. That wasn't the case. We were called the blended family from hell. Oops. slip. But anyway, everyone is respectful and kind because everyone practices safe conversations now. And we have healthier bodies. We have healthier brains as a result. So thank you for allowing us to share the science.
Absolutely. Do you think that this event will look back on it as a time of unity where we suddenly didn't look at each other based on their country or race or religion, that it's a human race fighting a common enemy?
I think so. I think I had this fantasy recently. I sort of love star science fiction and, you know, fantasize about, are there aliens and so forth, and what would happen if they came? They'd probably unify the planet. And then it's like, well, the aliens didn't come, but an alien did come in the form of a microorganism. And posed a threat that is really real, that the aliens, if they came, might not really do. They may be friendly. But what's happened is that we are discovering our interconnectivity, and we're discovering it through the actual transmission of the virus itself, that it goes from person to person and is producing chaos across the world, and of sickness across the world and deaths across the world. And so what we're discovering is that we are intricately connected. There's no person who is separate, no person who is by themselves. And if we help each other, we can then come to terms with this threat. And that's one of the messages, by the way, that I saw this morning in the newspaper, a plea for all of us to be aware that everything we do impacts what happens to other people, and that we have to be sure that what we do helps them rather than hurts them. And we would say that's one of the best messages that we can get. We are one, we are connected. What happens to one happens to all. And so let's be in there and with each other. Yes.
Well, if I may, I'm going to bring in Sarah and Caleb in Plano. Hey guys, so you have been homebound now for 2 weeks. What is that like?
That's right. It's been 2 weeks. What day is it today? Do you remember what day it is today? It's all running together now, isn't it, Caleb?
I think Friday.
Nope, it's Monday.
It is running together.
Caleb and I are in the middle of learning what a, I guess it's a new normal, right, Caleb, in a way? It feels different. And, we were talking about this ever since it started. Life was just so busy, wasn't it, Caleb? And now it feels what?
Feels like time has stopped.
Feels like we're frozen in time, doesn't it? Yeah. You had this interesting analogy of a bird. Share that.
Like, you know how there's like a window and then a bird, and if the bird like flies in into the window, we're at like that splat point, just stopped.
Yeah, we're pretty much frozen in time right now. But in a way, it's been kind of beautiful, and you know, we're learning what a new normal is, being at home together all of the time, 24/7, right? Uninterrupted, Helen, in a way.
Harville and Helen, you're so good at coaching. I know you have some questions of Caleb and Sarah. What would you like to ask?
Well, I'd like to ask sort of, how stressful has it been? How have you dealt with the fact that you're in the house and it's a new normal that must have changed your routines, put some stress? So how's that going?
You want to start, Caleb?
Pretty stressful.
Pretty stressful.
Yeah.
We went from a normal routine. I think if I could speak for you, Caleb, the realization that you weren't able to go out and play with friends, that was a pretty tough day, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. I can imagine.
I miss my teachers now.
They said you miss your teacher now?
Yes.
Yeah. So is that new for you? Did you miss your teacher before?
No.
Yeah, so that's new, that you now miss your teacher and miss your, I'm guessing, miss your friends at school as well, and so forth. It's kind of an isolating moment.
So, Caleb, I just want to say we appreciate very much your doing this and showing up, because, other people are at home, and your mom looks like a really nice person, but maybe people have parents they're scared of, and imagine if your parents were scary. Anyway, we're gonna thank you for helping us. We're gonna teach you all how to begin to talk to each other in a different way, and it's gonna help a lot of people. So anything else, Sarah, you would like to talk about right now, or you, Caleb, before we begin to teach you safe conversations?
Yeah, I think the big realization for us was that we, in a way, I don't know if you were feeling this way, Caleb, too, was we were taking so much for granted, being able to just walk across the street and go say hi to the neighbors or go to the grocery store even. And, you can still do those things, but when we're talking about social distancing, you're right, Harville and Helen, it's more that physical distancing where we can make that social connection, and you guys are truly doing that. So what I want to say right now is thank you, because this is such an opportunity to be able to experience your mission, you know, face-to-face through this communication that you're creating for us. So we do want to say thank you, right, Caleb?
Yeah. You know, yeah. We appreciate the opportunity to talk with you and hear about your private situation at home, and also your availability to get a tip or two about how you might de-stress and improve the connection.
So Caleb and Sarah, we will now share the process of safe conversations. And there's a safe conversation dialogue, and it's three steps, but we're just going to do the first step on this call. But at the end of this call, at the end of this show, people will be able to do it at dinner tonight. And the safe conversations is where one person wants to say something, and we're going to ask it to be sharing an appreciation. And rather than just blurting out an appreciation, the first thing you do is you ask for an appointment. And who would like to go first? Would it be Caleb or Sarah?
I'll go first.
Okay. So Sarah, would you just say to Caleb, hey, Caleb, right now I'd like to share an appreciation that I have for you. Is now a good time?
Hey, Caleb, I'd like to share an appreciation with you. Is now a good time?
Yeah.
Okay. Caleb, you said yes, but we're going to use this process if your mom has a frustration with you. And maybe if she goes, hey, Caleb, I'd like to share a frustration right now. Is now a good time? You might say, oh, yeah. Or you might say, actually, I'm putting together a dinosaur right now and I'm busy. How about in 30 minutes? And then you could do this in 30 minutes. But anyway, Sarah, he said yes. And so,
yeah, I think it's important to underline that it is okay to say, I'm not available right now, because sometimes you're just not available. Can say, well, I would be in 10 minutes or 30 minutes, and to make that okay in the conversation. So that's not a point of conflict.
Because at that point, you can turn around and give the person talking to you your undivided attention and really pay attention. So it's fine to say no, now is not a good time for a frustration or an appreciation. But anyway, he said yes. So this now is the beginning of the dialogue. So Sarah, you asked to talk. So you're the sender. Caleb, this means you're the receiver of whatever your mom's going to say. And when your mom tells you an appreciation, do not say, oh, I'm not really, or I'm not really that way, or do not answer her with your thoughts. You have to empty your mind and mirror her back and see if you've got it right. And then your mom will say, she'll mirror you back and she'll say, did I get it? And if she got it right, you say yes. And if not, tell her what you said more. And then your mom might ask, is there more about that? And she'll let you talk a little bit more. And basically that's the beginning of the appreciation. And Harville will walk you through it.
Okay, so Sarah, you're going to start ask Caleb if he's available for an appreciation. And Caleb will say, yes. Okay, so let's do that.
Hey, Caleb, I want to share an appreciation with you. Are you available? Is this a good time?
Yes.
Thanks for repeating that.
Okay. And so now you say, well, my appreciation of you is?
Caleb, my appreciation of you is?
And then give him the appreciation.
You are so creative. You are the most creative kid ever. I appreciate that about you. You're so creative, and it inspires me to be creative myself.
And so, Caleb, what we want you now is to, we call it mirror that back, which is to repeat back to your mom what she said her appreciation of you is.
And you can't, can't be creative.
So mom, if I got that.
Mom, if I got that, you're saying that I'm very creative.
Did I get that?
Did I get that?
Sure did.
And then say, well, is there more about that, Mom?
Is there more about that, Mom?
Yes, actually, there is more about that.
And the more is?
The more is that when you're creative, that inspires me, and I see that it inspires others too. I appreciate that you're creative. It inspires me. It inspires others. And you have a heart for sharing your creativity with others.
So
that inspires me.
Sorry to interrupt that, but if I got that, the more you wanted to say is?
So if I got that, the more you wanted to say is that I inspire other people to be creative?
Yes.
Did I get that?
Did I get that?
Sure did, yes.
Well, thank you for sharing that with me.
Thank you for sharing that with me.
And now, are you available? Ask your mom for me to give you an appreciation.
Are you available for me to give you an appreciation?
Definitely.
My appreciation is, I think you're the best mom in the world.
So if I got that.
So if I got that, you feel that I'm the best mom in the world? Really? Me?
Yes.
So, and then say, is there more about that, Caleb?
Is there more about that, Caleb?
Yes. I think you will inspire other moms to be, or try to be, half as good as you.
Oh, wow.
Oh, so if I got that.
So if I got that, I'm such a great mom that I'm going to inspire other moms to be half as great as me? Wow, Caleb.
So with Caleb, thank you for sharing that with me.
Caleb, thank you for sharing that with
me. Wow.
Wow. You're the best kid ever, you know that.
Thanks.
Yeah.
That's
wow, great. Guys.
We would have asked you to hug each other and you did it spontaneously, which means that the process connected you there immediately. So thank you for learning that, and we want you to use that in your own life, and there are other topics that we can talk about. But now you have been a demonstration of a process for other people who can use it in their families in this time of crisis. So thank you for being willing to teach that to anybody who shows up to watch this show.
Once you learn to do it with an appreciation and you get good at it, then you can begin to say, hey, I have a frustration I'd like to share with you.
Yeah.
And work on
and
that.
And so we may do that at another time.
Yes. But stick with the appreciations for now.
Yeah.
Until you get the mechanics of the process.
So would you like to just give the give us and whoever might be watching just a little feedback about what it was like to do that? I can see it touched Helen and with tears, and it looked like it touched you also at the emotional level. So we just put into words a little bit about what it was like to make that exchange using those phrases.
Well, I love that you asked us that question. For me to be able to repeat back Caleb's very touching words hit me very emotionally. Mm-hmm. And it was almost this like disbelief, like, this is, you really feel this way? So for him to validate that and look at me with these big Caleb eyes, yeah, that was really, really special.
Yeah. What was it like for you, Caleb?
I felt that it was a little long.
A little long?
Uh-huh. Like, maybe just asking if they're available and then saying it.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that maybe a few less instructions, just go ahead and do it.
Yes.
Okay. I think if you and I practice it a few times, maybe forever, it'll go by quicker. Is that what I'm hearing you say?
Yeah. You got it, Sarah. We can hear something mirrored back. And it is the case, once it becomes a habit, it moves very rapidly. But it is sort of slow when you're learning it, sort of like any other skill. It's a little bit of a dread of a drag, but once you get it, it then makes it possible to do it with elegance. But you all were magnificent, and I'm so appreciative, and we're so appreciative that we got to share that with you, and you shared yourselves with us.
So you're saying that you're very appreciative. Did I get that right?
You got it.
Thank you for mirroring us.
You that are, I want to give you another one. You are amazing.
I am amazing. Did I get that right?
and if you say, is there more? We have more to say. Yes. But Helen, you wanted to say something.
Well, the more you do it, the better you feel.
Yeah.
Because it puts you in the part of the brain. When you mirror people, you release different neurochemicals than when you answer, especially if you want to correct what the other person was saying. I used to love talking in our relationship, and actually now I love mirroring Harville.
Yeah.
Because it calms me down, and it releases norepinephrine, acetylcholine, and the neurochemicals of peace, like prayer and wonder, are calming neurochemicals that feel better.
Yeah.
And just that you would pick that right back up and mirror us is very touching.
Yes.
And that's the goal. Once you start it, Harville talks about that he talks about relational competency. Just do it all the time.
Yeah. Right. It's like a skill. You practice until you become an artist at the skill, and then it goes fast. And you all are great students, so I'm sure this is going to, and you integrated it immediately.
Do you want to mirror that back, Caleb?
You're saying that we're great students. Am I getting that correct?
You got it correctly.
And I was joking.
Caleb loves jokes.
Yeah. Well, so do I. So thank you.
Here's what touched me. We're talking about a global pandemic and something where there is no cure at this point. The human race is racing to find a cure. But when I first met you guys several years ago, I felt like you had found a cure. You had found a cure for a disease that is infecting homes around the planet. And it's your purpose on this planet to share that good news. And so watching you, Helen, tear up at this magic that you helped create, I thought was beautiful. Can you tell me what was going on in your heart when Caleb was saying those things and you started to tear up?
I was tearing up because of her tears, Sarah's tears. I saw her tears. And what was in my heart was, Caleb felt that way and she didn't know. He hadn't stopped and told her. She might have thought, I'm doing this work for Caleb and he doesn't appreciate me, and he took the time to tell her how he felt, and she was so touched and surprised, as were we. that he could get to the essence of how he really feels about her. So it was just, the way I see it is, if we can get this out, Jeff, we could prevent so much unnecessary suffering at home that people are struggling with. And they did such a beautiful demo. So I was really appreciative.
And I want to add that not only is it a relational de-stressing, but just underline again what the research shows, and we want to say, is that when you have those kinds of interactions and you activate those chemicals, what's called the feel-good chemicals, they feed your immune system. And your immune system is the number one bulwark against getting sick. And so healthy relationships that where there is emotional expression and emotional understanding and acceptance is one of the best defenses against one of the most virulent diseases we've ever had on the planet. So there are other things that are the scientists are saying we should and must do, which is wash your hands and also eat the right sort of diet, be sure to sleep enough, and keep your distance from other people. But the one thing that's most important is not physical distancing, although that's absolutely required and necessary, but it's social connecting, because that gives us hope, feeds the immune system, and then the disease ultimately doesn't stand a chance against people who are connecting.
So we are almost out of time for this episode. So I want to give you guys a chance to kind of tease or forecast upcoming episodes. I know you've got big plans for this webisode series. Helen, I know you have endless contacts around the globe. What do you envision for this series?
Oh, there's a man in Iran named Ali who's been texting us the last couple of days. Can you send us a video? Because we're having our new year. And the Safe Conversation, the training has gone, there are people doing Safe Conversations in many countries. So I'd love on the series for some of them to weigh in, because if you're doing it here in Dallas, it's also being done all around the world. We do have a book that if you want to learn more about it, it's called The Space Between, and you could go to our website to learn about Safe Conversations.
And the website is safeconversations.org.
And we'll put that up on the screen as well. Well, this has been a wonderful show. Thank you to Harville, Helen, and Sarah and Caleb in Plano, and thank you for making it just a magical show. We're going to close with one of the highlights that I've seen on video in a while. It's a choir group that had to be in isolation. They couldn't practice together, but they certainly came together in great harmony. So we're going to close with that video.
Thank you. bird.